Guys, these great musical directors. So, hey, I'd like to thank all of you, Onree, Kenny, Daniel, Adam, you know, of course, Ray, for coming on. And we'll just get this going. Y'all know we can cut up. If we start cutting up, we'll never finish. So. What is a power MD? To me, a power MD is somebody that they're not just running a band. Okay, they're running a production. Every show that they do is more of a production. It's not just, okay, I'm MD'ing this artist and I just got to get a group of guys together that can handle their instruments. A power MD, in my opinion, is a MD that hires MDs. What I mean by that is simply they want people that they can put on their instrument, put on their post, and they don't have to look at them no more, period. Because the last thing a MD of these guys' caliber needs is a headache worrying about, oh man, is the drummer really going to count this off right? Is he going to be on the click? Is the bass player going to hit that first note on the downbeat? Did the keyboard player do the right patch? Is he doing too much? Are they walking the line director? Are they keep kind of guys, what they do is they're watching directors, line producers, TV producers, sometimes arrangers. The artist has their managers there looking at them. An MD could have like a headset on with multiple packs, one pack, two pack, three. I've witnessed this. I've worked with these guys and they are all incredible. These are, I'll say five of, it's not the only five, let's put that out there, but five of the greatest musical directors that the world has to offer. Mr. Onree Gill tours John Mayer, Gwen Stefani, Adam Levine, Kelly Price. You and I were both with Kelly, right? I was musical director. And P. Diddy, Stevie Wonder, Paul Simon, Alicia Keys for many years. The Jacksons as well. Jade, you and I both were with Jade. Lenny Kravitz, we both were with Lenny Kravitz. Jill Scott, I did a run with you with Jill Scott. And Quincy Jones, the Grammys, BET Awards, Soul Train Awards, Tonight Show, Good Morning America. And he's a big record guy. This guy used to walk around with an MPC 60 under his arm. And drive all the way out to my house, man. We would do tracks together. You'll find him on records with Will I Am, the Black Eyed Peas, Britney Spears, Jade, Mary J, Jennifer Hudson, Stevie Wonder. And I'm gonna start with this because this is really incredible. This guy did a song. He produced a song with Will I Am that NASA, they sent it to the moon, or was it Mars?
Mars.
They sent it to Mars. So him and Will I Am have a song on Mars. Mr. Onree Gill, you are definitely, like the rest of this panel, a power MD. And yes, you are definitely that talent.
First of all, let me say, how do you get a song on Mars?
Did you say me? Did I play on that track? Because I want to know if I'm on Mars. Because you know, you send me a lot of tracks and I'll play on them and I don't know where they end up. Is that on Mars? Right.
No, that was all orchestration.
Oh, okay.
It's like a six-piece orchestra. First of all, I want to say it's such a pleasure to be on this panel with all these guys, and it's even greater honor to call you guys my friends. All you guys are like amazing at what you do and have great accomplishments, and it's just an honor to be here with you guys, and thank you for even having this conversation to enlighten people.
Somebody just posted on Facebook a whole bunch of spaceships. I just want you to...
Well, I mean, I'll talk about that briefly. Will.i.am called me one day and said that NASA had this Curiosity rover going to Mars, and that he needed a song. So we got together, basically wrote this song, and I just did all the orchestration. I had like a 56-piece orchestra, and I played drums, and we kept it all classical. And when the rover landed on Mars, it sent back the signal to Earth to let us know that the mission was successful. So yeah, I got a song on Mars, and Quincy Jones has a song on the moon. So
Onree Gill, Quincy, that's crazy, and Will.i.am are in outer space. Anybody got some Star Wars music? Kenny, play some Star Wars music real quick. Bro, like, so. I mean, listen, we sitting here trying to figure out, like Adam said, and Daniel said, how can we get record and work with each other via this kind of platform without no latency? I guess there was a lot of latency when that signal came back from Mars, right?
Yeah, millions. Millions of miles. Would it happen?
Did you hear it play from Mars?
Yeah, it's on the internet too. You can find it. It's on the internet. It was pretty cool. Probably NASA.com has some kind of archive of it, I'm sure, on there. But
did they do like some corny comic illustration of like you and Will.i.am in spacesuits, like kind of floating?
They came in and cut some stuff while we were in the studio recording, and they did like a documentary on the side about it. Wow. So it's somewhere on the Science Channel somewhere.
That's crazy. So, and there's a reason why they did that. Okay, take music out of society and what would you have? I guarantee you that's why it's on the moon and that's why it's on Mars. There's a reason that
it started in heaven. So you had two things. You had God, and there was music too in heaven. Right. So.
Where were you born, Onree?
All right. Shout out to the Bronx, though. Hold up. So I was born in a little...
Where the Yankee cap at? You always got the NY. Okay.
I know I'm a New York Knicks fan.
He got that Brown. Knicks and Yankees on heavy.
Yep, that Yankees and them Giants. So you know I'm going down with the ship. So
yeah,
we're just going to turn into a submarine because that's what's going to happen. So, but I was born in a little town called Kannapolis, North Carolina, where who else is from there? George Clinton's from there and Nick Cannon. So I was born there, and then my parents moved to New York to the Bronx when I was like 2 months old. Mm-hmm. So, I'm from the Bronx.
Household of music?
Yeah, my dad was a musician. It was kind of scary because he was just, back in the day, he wrote songs with like Freddie Jackson and GQ, and you know was working with them in the studio and stuff like that. So I remember as a kid, he would take me to the studio, and I would just sit there and watch them dudes record song after song.
Wow, what was that like? He was playing piano.
Yeah, my dad was playing piano. I didn't know that much. I knew it was fun because I wasn't home, so I would sit down and just watch those guys play. I didn't know exactly what they were doing, but you know, I had a love for it because my mother took me to church, and I was basically fascinated by drums.
Right. So, early in life, did you go straight into music education, or was it something else you were trying to go to?
No, growing up, I played drums in church, and that was it until I got to high school. Then I started playing drums and getting excited about other instruments like the bass and piano in high school. Mm-hmm. And then after that, I was kind of, I was like 16. I started producing for like Christopher Williams and stuff like that. And then I went on the road with Al B. Shore and then other stuff. And then one day, at that time, it was different things going on at that time. And then one day, well, let me make that short. After that, later on, I did go to college. I went to Manus, the new school, and I studied.
How long after that was that?
Oh, man, that was close to 2000 or something like that. So I was already well into my career, but it was certain things as a music director that I had to sharpen my skills. So I didn't know everything, so I wanted to be the best I could be. So even in the midst of that, when I had downtime, I went back to school to study. And I just want to say real quick, I got to say this, that Ray Chu is one of the biggest inspirations in my life. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to say that to him before we go any further, because if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't have definitely... Ray was the one who hired me for Alicia Keys. I want to be clear with that.
Wow.
So he called me one day, and he was like, I was already working. I think we had worked together on Missy Elliott or something like that. And I was, he was like, hey, you know, I got this artist that I want you to work with. And that's how that happened. But I met Ray way before that, because I used to sneak into the Apollo when I was like 14, 15 years old, just to hear the bands. And I would be like, hey, Ray, I tried to go and talk to Ray. Hey, man, how you doing? Because I just wanted to know him. Mm-hmm. You know what? He was never a jerk. He wasn't like, who's this kid? Get him out of here. Like, move. He was always kind and showed me love. So I have to shout out Ray Chu. A lot of stuff happened in my life, my career, because of him.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Man, yeah. A few words.
All good. All good. All good.
I think I had a stressful moment when one time it was at Madison Square Garden, and I was with Alicia Keys, and we were doing a huge show, and we had a surprise that Beyonce was getting ready to come out.
Oh, wow.
So we're in the song that it's called Put in a Love Song that Beyonce and Alicia Keys did together. So everything's cool, things are fine. The power for the monitor console goes out. And at that same time when it goes out, Beyonce starts singing. Let's do a set. It was crazy. So basically, you know, all the musicians were like this. They started to panic, and I just calmed them down. I said, take one ear out. We're going to have to listen to the PA and play with the PA. And I just conducted them. So that was probably one of the most stressful times, but we got through it. You're pros. So when things happen, mm-hmm. you know, we put those fires out really quickly. So right. I won't say we have embarrassing moments, but there's issues that happen all the time. Yeah, I've been on a gig where I was playing drums and the guy was playing, MD was on the piano, and we had NPCs at that time. He hit the wrong song. Mm. He panicked, couldn't stop it. So I had to kind of get off and hit the button for him. You know, so I mean, things has happened, right. But that's music business. You know what I'm saying?
So as a power MD, give an example of maybe one of your most exhausting times, busy times. Like I witnessed one with you.
That was the gig that I was working with Adam on too. I was calling him like, "Yo, is everything cool with Jill? Everything blah 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 blah." So listen, you need to ask that question to Adam, because Adam is the one who does multiple gigs at the same time. I might have had like five or six, but he had like.
I think we all got that gift and curse at the same time, man.
Yeah. Yeah.
At that time, I was on Team Onree, so you know it was all good. We was making sure everybody, we all cover it, you know.
I love this connection, man. I love the connection.
Oh yeah. And you know what? I want to say that these guys, just to say this, are some of the best individuals I've ever met. They're brothers. There's no ego, and they've always been able to help each other out. You know, because somebody could say, "Hey, well, you know, Adam helped him out. Let me call Adam next time." They're respectful, and anytime you move to a certain place that somebody's been, I remember getting calls from Adam or Ray or whatever, say, "Hey, I'm moving here. Everything cool?" I mean, it doesn't get any better than that, because, you know, musicians, you know, they see a paycheck and they just don't care about relationship. And in this business, know this, relationship is everything.
Everything.
Right.
You know what I mean? Everything. That's how you get into the next gig, is the relationship.
Right.
So you don't smash on your friend or the other person, because you never know when it's going to come back to you.
Right.
When you might know.
Absolutely.
Going on the road became something that was necessary. So, you know, you got bills, you got responsibilities. So I had to just get up and start working. Then I started playing drums. And I was like, wait a minute, keyboard player making more than a drummer? Mm-hmm. Yo, I got to start playing. I'm playing the wrong instrument. Yeah. Well, he's getting like $600 more? Nah, I got to switch. So that's what I did. I switched. So I was like, I need to get that bag. So, but I like production now. You know, it's something sweet about just like being able to write and seeing your thoughts through music. So mm-hmm. That's what I enjoy mostly.
Yeah. Well, how was it like when you were conducting the orchestra for the Grammys and you were standing on that platform with your New York Yankees cap turned to the side with a tuxedo on and some Uptowns? Or was it Adidas? Was it Shell Tops or Uptown? You had to keep it Bronx, right? How did that feel, man? How did that feel? What was that like?
It was an honor to feel like, you know, as a black man to be on such a prestigious platform, mm-hmm. you know, and I don't know how many, you know, black men have conducted on the Grammys, but I just thought it was an honor. And I, you know, I cherish that moment because there are few, you know, there are few of them. And I don't know if it's a feeling of just like, wow, you did it. You know, it's like almost winning a championship, like you won the finals for mm-hmm. me. That's mm-hmm. just how I felt, like without a hitch, you know, nothing went wrong. It was a beautiful performance. It was like, hey, I just won the finals.
You said people that black men that have come before you and have done things, of course, Ray. What about some others like Quincy Jones? Is he a big mentor of yours? And
I mean, I think Quincy is everybody's mentor on mm-hmm. this panel. I mean, he's influenced us in some aspect. I had the honor to work on the Grammys with Rachel and Quincy one time. Mm-hmm. And I mean, just to sit there and, you know, I shut my mouth. I knew, you know, this was the time to absorb everything these dudes are doing. Mm-hmm. And that's what I did. It was an honor. It's amazing what you can learn from those dudes if you just be quiet and listen. Mm-hmm. Most people, you know, are arrogant. They feel like they know everything. If you just eat that humble pie, you learn a lot.
You were heavy into Miles, named one of your children after him.
Yeah.
What kind of influence did Miles Davis have on you?
My sister and I would take the train. Shout out to Kenesha. Mm-hmm. So we would take the train to New Jersey from New York, and we get on the bus every Sunday. And the bus driver was playing all these records. I'm like, so I would sit as close as I could to the bus driver just to listen to what he was playing. So he saw it was an interest for me. So he said, "Hey, young man, I'm going to have something for you next week. Just make sure you come in next week." All right, I got you. And I came the next week and I got on the bus and he gave me a cassette. He said, "Listen to this and study it and really get into it." And it was the Kinda Blue album by Miles Davis.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So, And it just didn't, it just, I don't know, resonated with me. And it was just it was something just fascinating for me. And I listened to the album over and over and over again to just, you know, learn from it. For me, it was the approach of how, I mean, some people say, hey, you know, this one can play better than Miles, this one can play. It was just Miles' style, his approach, and how he, the musicianship that he put together, the musicians that he put together to play his records. So I felt like it was abstract, but yet it was current during that time. It was special. So that's what did it for me. You can have phenomenal players come into your circle, and then there's no chemistry. It's just the band featuring them. So, and with Miles, you know, it was like all of them had great chemistry, and they knew that they were supporting Miles. Miles was the head honcho. Miles had the voice. And what we're going to do is we're going to support him. And when there's areas that's open that need to be filled, we got them. And that's what I got from that. Nowadays, you know, musicians, like Adam said, they're phenomenal. And listen, the next generation is going to be even better and better and so on and so on. But you don't, if you take them out of what they're doing, they still don't have the fundamentals. A lot of them don't know the fundamentals. Like, hey, like I tell people all the time, when I play with Alicia, yeah, I use all 10 fingers. But when I play with John Mayer, I use 3 because that's all that was necessary. I didn't need to play, you know, 10 finger chords. I did that because I was having fun. But I played the part when I was MD for John Mayer because that's what all was necessary. He didn't want 11s and 13s in his music because that's not what it was. It was a straight E major chord. So play E major.
Right.
And you have to know when to say, hey, I could play this, I could do that. But guess what? All that's required of me to do is play that E major, and I'm hot doing it. Not because I didn't play E11. First of all, I want to shout out Adam because he is the music director for Alicia Keys now.
Oh, okay.
All right. Yeah. So Adam does a great job. But
following these guys' footsteps. That's all, man. It's going good. It's going good. You set the foundation all the way from the back.
Yeah. Well, thank you, bro.
That's me a too. Big deal, man. Because I want to just say real quick, like, even going through the times with different artists, and I'm not trying to step on Onree's time, but they, you know, Mariah and, you know, Anita Baker, we've talked through some of these, and even, you know, Kenny's shows, like, they have a sound. Like, you know, these artists have a sound. So it's like I'm just regenerating, if that's a good word I could use, you know, maybe put a little spin on it for 2 bars somewhere else. But it's like I'm still, you know, playing the record and what you guys, you know, in a lot of cases have already established. So, like, I just want to big up, you know, I didn't know that Ray put Onree on Alicia. Like, that's so dope to me to know that, you know, rocking with her now. It's like, you know, man, we still playing fall. We still playing fall in the Ray True way. Like, it is what it is.
That's what I'm saying.
You know what I mean?
And if I could interject too, you know, in playing the record, you know, and what Onree's talking about for all the younger musicians, the actual sound, you know, just because it's a piano part, you know, you got to sometimes know what keyboard they had, what module they had, you know, the actual sound, because sounds cut through the mix.
Yeah, man.
So if you just pull up the first piano patch you have and it's not the jive from the record, it's not going to feel the same.
Absolutely.
And I got to add into that as well.
Yeah.
I was going to say, because especially in doing the Temptations music, you know, there's a sound, there's a Motown sound. My bass player, George Farmer, has the same 1969 Fender Precision that James Jameson used to play.
Yeah.
Down there, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, from the drum skins, you know, to everything, to the heads, to the mics, to where they're placed, to the piano, and the whole big on sounds. Everything can't just be a piano patch.
Right.
You know, if you're going to have a Rhodes, whether you have the tines a certain way, you can hear the pedal, you know, all that stuff plays a part. And I also have to thank Ray, because I learned a lot from working with him on the Apollo as well, when he used to bring me in at the Apollo. And just so much, you know, about the right sound and how to get that feel, you know. So I gotta add to that. I
got a couple of guys on here who all you guys might know. These two guys are MDs as well. Matt Oerstreicher.
Thanks for doing this. This is amazing. I really appreciate just what I've heard and being part of it. And it's crazy, the view now of seeing all of you together, Adam, Kenny, Daniel, Ray, Onree. It's so awesome.
Cool.
So glad to see you. I'm glad to be here. So I made some notes because I wanted to get to the point when you told me, I want to say something because I want to hear more. I think the two big things is they talked a lot about, I heard a lot about mentorship, and I got that mentorship from Onree, who brought me into the Apollo about 10 years ago. And then Ray, who after that I had the honor to work with many times. So the two things I want to say is like, what I learned from, at first from Onree being at the Apollo, it changed my whole idea of what a musician was. Because I always thought you play a song and you learn some chords and maybe you find some sounds and okay, I'm playing the song. But the level of quality, which I think is a big part of why I used to watch Ray Chu on Showtime at the Apollo when I was a kid, and now he's still doing it and everybody here is doing it. You know, I know Kenny's band from Ain't Too Proud, and just the level of quality of the team and the level of quality of expectation mm-hmm. that you get working with an Onree and a Ray is, it's not you're playing the song, it's basically like you're a producer mm-hmm. when you show up and you learn. You say, it's not good enough to have an orchestra hit for Poison. You grab that sound from Poison. So the level, and I know, you know, and I see like in the comments, Artie and with Anthony, like they're always, every time I'm on a gig with them, they're talking about new gear they're learning and Ableton and this, and you're, and just having all those new skill sets and staying contemporary. Kenny talking about Q-Labs. And then just the one other thing was the amount of pressure and the situations I've been in and watched the people like Ray and Onree. And literally, like I said, Onree, we were taping TV show, there's a fire on stage. Onree's putting it out while we're playing, the thinking on the feet. And there's one other thing about that. So it's like more like I watched them in like more of a CEO role. Someone said, several people said, Ray is like the godfather. It's like a godfather / CEO role where you're no longer in your little world of music, of your playing.
Right.
You're seeing everything, hearing everything. So like Adam said, 35% music and everything is everything else. So yeah, I think those are the big things. I mean, I could go on forever, but I really want to listen more. So
got Matt. Matt was like, he was my assistant because I was doing other stuff as well. So Matt was the one who was charting for me. So he made my job easy. So that all I had to do was come in and read the chart and play. You know? And he was great. And you know what? The Apollo, as Ray knows, you know, Reggie and Anthony, you guys know that it's you don't get to practice all these songs. It's mm-hmm. just get up there, and you know Kenny too. You get up there, that chart comes up there, and you go. Mm-hmm. There's a count off, and that's it. So we don't have time to make corrections, take a pencil, change this. It's all on the fly. And it's one of the hardest jobs to do. So I commend all you guys who've done the Apollo Theater, especially Ray. Because Ray is the pioneer of that, you know? So him and Frank Owens just made that what it is.
Anthony yep. Miller.
But before I say anything, I just want to thank all you guys on the panel. You guys like paved the way for like musicians like myself to become like an MD. Of course, Onree, I've worked with Onree so many times, and Ray Chu, and the rest of the guys. I listen to you guys, watch you guys on shows all the time. So you guys are like my mentors. And I just want to say that before I say anything. Mm-hmm.
What's it like working with Ray Chu?
Wow. So it's like working with Ray Chu. Ray Chu's still on here, right?
Yep.
Yeah, man.
yeah, what? You going to suck about him?
Oh, wait.
I probably was the same way Reggie was the first time I worked with Ray Chu. I was kind of like just nervous. Like, you know, me knowing the history of Ray Chu, I'm just like, man, this is like Ray Chu. Like if you're into sports, it's like, oh man, this is Michael Jordan. I realized that because like somebody just said, if it's just an E major chord, just play an E major chord and it gets you work for the next gig. It doesn't matter how many inversions or reharms I could do with it. So I kind of learned how to be like a disciplined musician. So when Ray is around, it just kind of like puts you on your toes. You know, Ray's that businessman too. Just, like you said, you know, musicianship is probably 25-35% of it, but the rest is like you said, is chemistry. I think you guys said that reputation, is pretty much like your credit card, you know, in the music industry.
Yes, sir. I wanna switch to I used to watch him do karate in the dark at SIR Studios before rehearsal started. Y'all probably gonna know. Some of y'all might already know what I'm talking about, but I'm gonna just say, you know, he's orchestrated and arranged music for Fox, NBC, BET television networks, Broadway musicals like The Wiz. He was the dance arranger. We definitely gonna talk about that. And Ableton Live. He's in Fame. He was in the musical Fame. He was an actor in Fame in a church robe with a graduation hat on. I believe that. Memphis, the musical director and conductor for Memphis, the musical, winner of 4 Tony Awards, best new musical, best score, best book, best illustration. He's currently doing Ain't Too Proud, which is the musical on the life of the Temptations, musical director, arranger, which is another Tony Award winning show. Mr. Kenny Seymour.
What's going on, guys?
How are you, man?
Man, this is so good to see everybody. Just to be around everybody, especially during this time, and to have this energy coming back. Ray, man, it's such a pleasure to be here with you and everybody. You know, Reggie, Onree, we go back, you know. Daniel Adams, such a pleasure to see y'all for the, you know, in person. But I've heard so much about y'all, and it's just a pleasure to be in the room with y'all.
So what's up, man? How you been doing, man? What's going on with all these Tony Awards you're getting now? And I think the record went platinum.
Not yet. No, that it hasn't. But as far as like the Broadway aspect of it, and just like music in general, mm-hmm. it's been great. You know, I'm really fortunate. I'm blessed. You know, to be in a position that I am. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, as you know now, all the theaters are closed. Right. And everybody is, you know, pretty much working from home. But It's been a wonderful ride. I mean, I've come from the club dates here in New York from touring, and everything that I've done has kind of led up to where I am now. And I kind of take I take wisdom and experience and knowledge from every experience that I've had. I did anything, you know, touring wise.
Let's talk about Fame, man. Were you in Fame, or were you playing? It looked, because you was in, I don't know what was going on.
Okay, and I know you probably went on you Googled it. Yeah. So that was Fame the musical. It was at the old Coconut Grove Playhouse in Coconut Grove, Florida. Oh, and I played Mitchell Lee, which was like the Black Bruno who played, you know. So I played for like the dance classes, and I didn't have many speaking roles, but it was my first professional, you know, musical.
Wow.
That I was involved in. But yeah, no, that was a wonderful experience. And I think I was 17 when I did that.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I got my driver's license when I was doing that. So
yeah, you looked pretty young when you were doing that. Let's talk to me a little bit about The Wiz.
Yeah, I did that at the Coconut Grove Playhouse, and that was a reimagining of it. Where they kind of like reimagined it with from a hip hop standpoint. It had a lot of hip hop elements and everything. Really well done, really, really
so were
creative.
You a hip hop dancer? Because it says you did dance arrangements on that. Okay.
No, well, so dance arrangements in the theater world, pretty similar to what was mentioned before about catching hits. Every show has a choreographer. Mm-hmm. And there are certain musical numbers where they have extended dance numbers. And the music has to be arranged for those dancers. So they might have, they count in eights. So what we would call, you know, one bar, 1, 2, 3, 4, would be 2 bars, which is a count of 8 for really? Dancers. Yeah, so.
Oh yeah, 5, 6, 7, 8, right.
Right, Exactly. So we'd be at 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4. There, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Right, right.
Right. So dance arrangers would basically work with the choreographer on putting together musical arrangements for the dance numbers.
Every time I do speak to you, it looks like you're in a hotel room with what's the scoring software?
Finale.
With Finale up and a MIDI keyboard in front of you, and you got one hand on the keyboard, one hand on your computer. You're trying to talk to me on your headset, and you're on your way to do a gig that has nothing to do with what you're doing there.
When you're on the road and you're, you know, working with a particular artist, you know, there are other projects that you're working on. Sometimes I would get calls to do arrangements or charts, and I had even gotten some calls, a lot of them from Ray at some point, you know, to do. And you know, you're in a hotel room somewhere in Chicago, and you have to have a mobile setup to be able to work, mm-hmm. and to be able to, you know, generate those charts, you know, like we need them by 8 o'clock in the morning tomorrow, LA time. And so, you know, boom, you go in there and you bang them out, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But I think the mobile aspect of it has really played a big part in my life, being able to work from anywhere. A lot of times those particular scores are done what they call package deals, where, you know, they don't have a lot of funds because it's an independent score. So everything is done either in your studio on a laptop, or they're done, you know, you're responsible for getting the music to them.
And live orchestra plays on top of it, or you actually, or they're playing, or you don't do any software strings, or a combination of both? Like, what's happening with that?
There are sometimes where it's done live, and then there's sometimes when it's done all virtual, you know? It varies project to project.
Now, when you're doing Broadway, what's that schedule like? I don't do, you know, is it 2 shows a day, 3 shows a day? Is it still a discount Wednesday thing going on? Like, what's
that? Well, prior to this, 8 shows a week. Sometimes there are 9, depending upon if they have 5 show weekends. There is a lot of pre-production. A show can sometimes take 5 years to get to Broadway.
What?
Yeah. So, I mean, Memphis, before it got to Broadway, it was in California, and then it went through a bunch of different iterations, and then it went to La Jolla, then it went to Seattle. And I joined about 2 years prior before it came into Broadway.
I heard Broadway is very hard to get in, to put it that way.
You know what? Reading has a lot to do with it. It depends on the show. There are some shows which are groove shows, you know? Some shows where they're bio musicals. There are some shows where there's a lot of funk, there's rock, there's different, you know, genres of music. Then there are some shows that are more traditional, or what they call, mm-hmm. you know, like the My Fair Ladies and the Phantom of the Opera, and things which require a different level of reading. Reading, I think, is necessary throughout all of theater, as far as, you know, but the levels in which, you know, you read, you know, I mean, even for rehearsal pianists, there are rehearsal pianists that just come in and, yeah. It's like opening up a newspaper, you know?
Yeah.
So, especially because things change so frequently during the development stage of theater. I mean, I remember at one point during Memphis, we were in previews, and they changed the entire opening number the night before. Mm. And so the next day we came in, you know, we had a continuity call, and boom, new opening number. And then we went back.
I like that, a continuity call. What's a continuity call?
So you have a certain amount of rehearsal, mm-hmm. before you go into previews.
I'm definitely using that phrase.
Yeah.
I like that. Yeah. Daniel, we got to use that. We give it a continuity call.
Continuity call. I had to back that one up.
Once we have the orchestra there, after we are rehearsed and we do all the music and everything, we go into the preview stage. There are continuity calls, which are additional rehearsal hours that are usually given either before half hour, which is, you know, the time you're supposed to be there before you play the show. So usually 7:30 for an 8 o'clock show, 6:30 for a 7 o'clock show. But they are extra slots of time that's allowed for sudden changes.
So y'all got that, right? Everybody, the panel got that? I'm gonna use that when church got back up.
Take
it. Man, Kenny, Memphis, man, four Tonys. That's huge, man. I mean, what was that like?
Well, you know, Memphis was a special show. That was one of my first, not my first, but my first Broadway show. Artie Reynolds was actually on. That was Hot Feet.
See that?
The music of Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Artie's everywhere.
And he was playing bass.
He got hot feet.
But Memphis was a special show because that was the first Broadway music direction show that I had. And it was such a special time, man. It's like the cast was phenomenal. The musicians were phenomenal. And it was just a wonderful show.
Now, ain't too proud.
Ain't too proud. Ain't too proud.
How proud are you?
Man, this is wonderful. I mean, the level of talent that we have in this show is, I mean, it's ridiculous. And plus, I get to work with my mentor, Harold Wheeler. He orchestrated the show.
Right.
And in this capacity, I'm the music director, the music supervisor, and the arranger.
One more.
All right.
Booth, you ready? Here we go.
All right, we are rolling.
And I mean, such a catalog, such a legacy, such a history. It's a wonderful, I never get tired of playing a show every night. I never get tired of it.
What's next for Kenny? Like,
I'm very pleased with the Broadway aspect of it and where I am. Mm-hmm. Of course, I grew up with dreams of being, you know, a John Williams, a Jerry Goldsmith, like, you know, we all talk about, we all love. Mm-hmm.
And who are those guys for the people that don't know? You just threw those names out.
All right. John Williams, legendary composer. For those who don't know, Star Wars, Raiders of the Lost Ark, Close Encounters of the Third Kind, you know, film after film after film after film. Mm-hmm. Star Wars was like one of the, episode four was one of the most, you know, iconic scores that influenced me and a bunch of other composers. And one thing I'd like to add there is that on the same thing that you just said, the industry is very small. Mm-hmm. You know, even though it's a large industry, it's very small. So one person that you're working for, one producer, they all know each other. Mm-hmm. And conversations do happen. So relationships are very, very important. Professionalism is very, very important.
Absolutely. But so Daniel, you did Neo, Anita Baker, Mariah Carey, Jennifer Hudson, the Jacksons, crazy. You've MD'd, you know, with the Daniel, the Super Bowl, Joyful Noise, Sunday's Best, Black Music Honors, Stella Awards, Apollo Live, Comic View, which is really dope. And you, and in TV, you've done some co-writing with theme songs, mixed use. You've scored for NBC's New Amsterdam. You've scored music for BET's Let's Stay Together. You and I were talking earlier this week, and you were like, man, I'm just honored, you know, to be up here with these guys. And I feel you on that. But clearly, clearly you belong on here. Okay. So, Vegas, correct?
Yes. So, first of all, everybody on the panel, I mean, this is a brotherhood, and I'm just honored to be amongst. But I moved to Atlanta in 2000. I was in college, and two of my roommates, Pierre and Dwayne, we were headed to a talent show, and we were introduced to Miss Casey, who was Brandon Bryan's mother, Jagged Edge. Mm-hmm. And Miss Casey moved us to Atlanta and started us in the studio with Jagged and called us a production team called the Corner Boys. So if any of you all remember the old Marcus Houston records or Marion, all that stuff, that was us. That's when I had big hair and dreads and stuff. So I kind of started my MD journey out of necessity. At that time, LaToya and Latavia had just left Destiny's Child, and they had started a group called Angel. And we had did a deal with L.A. Reid, but, you know, even in the midst of production and songwriting, I really wanted to be an artist. And I was trying to record and, you know, everything that people are doing on Instagram now, I was doing it my way back in 2000. But then in about 2001, you know, just to be candid for all the young, inspiring musicians here, I got my girlfriend pregnant. And I was 19 years old. And so I needed money now. I didn't know another way but to bring two or three keyboards, some amps, knew all the parts of the song, and try to be a chameleon. So if you call out outstanding, you know, I had your keyboard, your piano part, your horn part, and your string part with two hands somehow. And that was because I needed to keep that gig. So, I mean, you know, even though it was only $100 gig, you know, from 7 to 11, and then I go hit another lick at from 12 to 2 for $50, you know, that was diapers. So coming from there, exactly what Adam was saying, you know, people were walking into these clubs, and I got a call one time, I never forget, from Keisha Jackson, who's Billy Jackson's daughter. And she came to me and she said, so, hey, there's a TV show that's getting ready to happen, second season called Sunday Best. And Vivian, who's Ray's wife, had called her to put together some singers. Mm-hmm. And, you know, now, again, I was a keyboard player. So I was going to hand her, you know, a couple of singers. And she said, no, I need you. So I ended up taking the gig as a background singer.
Wow.
And not a keyboard player. And when Ray hired me, the first artist that was getting ready to be on the show was the Pace Sisters, which just so happened to be a record that I produced.
Really?
And so, which one?
24/7?
No. It was a record called It's Already Done.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, so Ray was like, oh, you did that? Okay,
already done.
That's it. He was like, all right, so we need a 3-minute version. So cut it up and I'll be right back. So
that's right.
So at the time, you know, I got on organ and, you know, he was like, oh, you play too.
Uh-oh.
So we ended up cutting the record, you know, chopping up the arrangement. We recorded it. That, for one, is a big experience for me because, you know, radio time, you know, 3 minutes, 30 seconds, 4 minutes, but TV time had to be right on the dot, you know? So how do I get all of these parts into this 3-minute edit? And so I met Jim and Ray at the same time on Sunday Best, which literally changed the trajectory of my career. So I want to give a huge shout out to Ray Chu. Because, you know, after that, everything just started escalating. And honestly, once again, in a direction that I didn't foresee coming, into the television world, into, you know, he had to go do another TV show. And he was like, you know, Anita Baker needs a keyboard player. So I need you to do these few hits for me. And then I'm gonna be right back. And then when he came back, she was like, okay, well, we're going to keep all three keyboard players. Wow. And once again, it was you know, I'm going to play the roles, you know, and, you know, Ray was always big on taking a module and a keyboard and, you know, MIDI-ing together to make sounds bigger and fatter. Mm-hmm. So, you know, his thing was, all right, so you play the horns, da da da. And he never really had to show me what part. He just called me the auxiliary guy. So I tried to figure out how do I build this track while I'm playing live. And so, you know, he would correct me certainly if it was the wrong part or if I had a note or something, you know, quite off. But, you know, it was about finding these different elements in the music and within the band, you know, the same way I would build a track. And then later the Monique Show, which is where I met Adam. So Adam was coming in as the MD for Queen Latifah. And I can't remember what tour they were on at the time, but she wanted to use the house band. So he came in and sat in and, you know, he gave the parts, you know, Lil John Roberts, shout out on drums. You know, is like a metronome.
Yeah.
So he knew everything. So between him and Adam, all we had to do was just find the chords and find the groove. And with doing that particular show, every segment had a bumper. And so each bumper, you know, we had to find original things. You know, even when we first started, she wanted to use...
Tell them what bumpers are. Tell the people what a bumper is.
A bumper is basically the music that plays as you're going into a commercial segment. Mm-hmm. So when you're doing an award show, you know, sometimes when after the performance or after the speech, you'll hear some music. And that's what we call bumpers. What I learned then is that, you know, people weren't actually playing vamps of previous songs. They were actually writing and scoring these bumpers. So that... back to my publishing days, that I was like, oh, here's another way to make money. Here's another way to, you know, get in to another thing, as well as, again, finding where I was within the band. Mm-hmm. Fast forward, you know, Sunday Best and all those things came back around. And unfortunately, we had lost Michael Jackson. Mm-hmm. So Kevin Dorsey had called because he was doing this big show in Wales. And he needed another keyboard player. I mean, when you have Greg Fillinganes and, you know, mm-hmm. some of the monsters, I don't know why you're calling me, but it was because, you know, well, you can play all these different parts. So this was the first time since the Victory Tour that the Jacksons had come together. And so they were coming in to do that show. But I wasn't able to do the tour with them because I went back to TV. So then they called me a couple years later because they were getting ready to do another tour, but Onree was the MD. So, you know, I'm saying also to say that, you know, these paths just crossed in a tremendous way. And Onree and I tried again with, when you're talking about the Jacksons, everything, every part means something different. Every lick, every hit, every, you know, it's a different dance move, you know. And it's like every precision, every part of that groove, if it don't sit right, the brothers can't dance. They can't sing. They can't, you know, they can't fall unless that groove is just where it was, you know. So right. I learned all these different things. And then, you know, Onree went to do other bigger things and left me with the kid. So fast forward, we going through that, you know, somehow we got the Mariah Carey call. And at the time, Randy was doing American Idol. And so we were getting ready to put together a tour with her, but she had always wanted to do Vegas. So we did a show called The Number Ones that was directed by Ken Ehrlich, who does the Grammys. And it was very interesting because she wrote all of her songs from Vision of Love all the way through Everything You Ever Heard. Unless it was a cover like I'll Be There, she wrote every one of those songs, which meant she knew every single part. She knew every precision thing. So for me, putting those shows together was, how do I recreate these records on stage once again? Mm-hmm. And when you sit in a Vegas show, you wanna experience everything you felt by that record. So how can I recreate that record on stage? So, you know, the first thing.
Let me ask you a quick question about that, right where you are. Absolutely. In recreating that experience, that record on stage, Vegas probably gives you more of an opportunity to do that, right? Because it's a theater that you're doing in all the time, right? So you can build theater around the artists.
Absolutely. When you're touring, you know, you're in a different venue every night. And so things are going to be different, you know, even though you're carrying your stage, depending on how many trucks, how large the tour is, you know, every venue, some of the, you know, laws are different. Sometimes you can't shoot the pyro as high. Sometimes you can't shoot it as all. Sometimes the noise metering is different. Sometimes you're outside in a amphitheater or something. So everything is different. But when you're in Vegas, you're sitting in a theater and you're creating that moment every night. So it's easier for me as a music director to not only rehearse the band, but then come out, listen to how it feels in the PA, listen to it how it feels in the in-ears, you know, have a continuity call with our lighting director or mm-hmm. with the choreographer or with, you know, just experiences. So all of these things are put together when you're just right there in that space. And it could take anywhere between a month to 6 months, mm-hmm. you know, to put together that Vegas show. And so the beautiful part about her is because she has so many hits, we were able to change that show maybe 3 or 4 times.
Wow.
So we started with the number ones, then we did the Butterfly Returns, then we did the Christmas show, then we did, you know, just different things to just keep people engaged because, you know, it's when you come to Vegas, you're really coming to experience the world. You know, so you're getting the New York casino, you're getting Paris casino, and each part is supposed to be for you to feel like you're in these different places. So when you come to a Mariah Carey show, we want to give you every aspect of Mariah and leave you wanting more. And hopefully when you come back, it's something fresh, it's something new, it's something, you know, different. I will share something that happened to me last year. We were in the Christmas show and we did a Vegas run and then we did an East Coast run and we ended up at Madison Square. The night before Madison Square, I was in the hotel and I fell in the bathroom and I hit my nose on the desk in front of me. So I was rushed to the ER and they had to literally restitch my nose together the night of the Madison Square show.
Wow.
And somehow, you know, I ended up still playing that show with a Santa Claus mask so that you couldn't see the stitching. But one thing, I say that to say, one thing that Ray, and he probably doesn't even remember this, he said to me a long time ago, you know, get involved with the union because the union is gonna have health benefits.
Mm-hmm.
And you never really know when you're gonna need that. Mm-hmm. And this was one of those times where, you know, I'm literally in the ambulance in New York City, headed to Mount Sinai in the emergency room. And, you know, somebody said, where's your insurance card? And, you know, what could have ended up being a $15,000, $20,000 bill in the midst of this pandemic while none of us were working, mm-hmm. ended up getting covered because Ray Chu told me to look into the union and make sure you get covered.
Isn't that something? I talk about that to guys as much as I can. I remember, but prior to being a part of the union, it was a difficult conversation for me to grasp because if you're not on a union gig per se,
mm-hmm.
you feel like you just always feel like an outsider. There's not a whole lot of support from the union if you're not on a union gig, but even not being on a union gig, you can still be a part and you can join and you can put into your pension and your health.
It's so important. You know, sometimes as musicians, we feel invincible mm-hmm. because we get so many amazing opportunities. And then something happens, and you can never plan, you know, thank God my wife was there with me to even get me to that hospital. But, you know, any other time I would have been in that hotel by myself. I would have tried to figure it out. And then you never know what could have happened in this time now. Now I'm trying to figure out, you know, $20,000 worth of health bills, and I can't tour. So, you know, I would say to all of the younger musicians, you know, look into, if it's not going to be the union or anything else, make sure you have some kind of insurance.
Wow. So what's next? What's next for you? What's next for Daniel?
What's next? Well, hopefully we're going to get back going. I'm still doing a lot of scoring, thankfully, working from home. So there's a couple of Fox shows that are coming out. We're getting ready to do the Stellar Awards coming up virtually. So, you know, just like Adam, I'm looking for a way where we could plug up live some interface, zero latency. Like Adam said, I believe this particular pandemic has changed the perception of large crowds forever.
Yeah. And I think in your situation, being in a fixed theater, and Kenny's situation, being in a fixed theater, it sounds like when it does come back, which, you know, musicians and everybody out here, it may be, ladies and gentlemen, next year. If you want to watch the Super Bowl or the All-Star game, go to his website. You'll know what I mean when you say it, when you look. He's toured, played MD, Janet Jackson, Maroon 5, Demi Lovato, Drake, Kanye West, Queen Latifah, John Legend, LL Cool J, Justin Timberlake. Again, he's with TV stuff, NBA All-Star Weekend, the Pepsi Super Bowl halftime show, which was amazing. The Grammys, Soul Train Awards, Dave Chappelle, when he was honored at the Kennedy Center. Done records with Al Green, Kendrick, Jill Scott, multiple records with The Roots, Music Soul Child, Jay-Z. What planet are you from, man?
That's all.
I'm just blessed, man. I'm thankful. You know, God has truly ordained my path.
All right.
I'm thankful.
Where's my organ? At?
All right. Go tune up. Yeah. Nah, but thanks, and it's an honor. I just want to say it's an honor to be in such great company. All of these guys played a role in what I do in my life. You know, I remember meeting Ray, and you know, I'm a questions guy. I ask a lot of questions, so he never was too busy to answer. Same thing with Onree. I asked a lot of questions, and that's just because I wanted to be great like they were.
Right.
I started off a theater guy. So Kenny, I watched Kenny a long time. He may not even know this, but like, you know, just watching his shows and how they develop. And then also, of course, through Big Jim, I got to know Daniel and his work. And one of my guys, Justin Gilbert, is really his guy. So we you know, have mutual great friends as well. So all of these guys, and then you, Reggie, like, you know, I can't play certain songs unless they just say, like, yo, dude, Reggie, like, what are you doing? Like, that ain't it. And we all know that to be true, right? It's like, yo, that's, you got to do the Reggie. They're like, what are you doing? Like, come on. So, nah, thank you for having me, man. I really appreciate it.
I greatly appreciate you being on here. Where were you born?
I was born in Trenton, New Jersey.
Okay.
I'm a Jersey guy, and that's more south. We moved to Willingboro, New Jersey, which is South Jersey, very close to Camden.
Okay.
And in 2000, I moved to Philadelphia and went to college there for jazz studies at the University of the Arts, and Philly adopted me.
Yeah.
I think even as an adolescent, I don't think I knew how close Philly was. You know what I mean? Everything seems so far when you're young. You know what I mean? I knew we were Sixers and Eagles fans, and we wasn't Giants and Knicks fans. So.
And it's a line drive kick. Jackson bobbles it and now has to try and recover. DeSean Jackson gets a block. Are you kidding? DeSean Jackson still not in and now in for the touchdown. No flags. Unbelievable.
It made all this. You know, we Eagles fans, But Philly adopted me and, you know, that was the start. The location for me was the start of everything. And then, you know, meeting who I met at that time.
So when you say the start of everything, what was like, what was your, I guess you, did you grow up in a household of music?
I did. My father is still a, what I want to consider now would just be like a one-man band, like wedding band type of guy. That wasn't the terminology when I was, you know, when he was working and when I was growing up, he was just a musician. You know what I mean? He was the best that I knew. Church, banquets, bar mitzvahs, all that was his living, you know what I mean? All days, all times. And
he played
keyboards.
Okay.
And, you know, like I said, looking back at it and even doing what I do now, you know, he would program all his drum beats. He would play left-hand key bass.
Wow.
He was doing all that he could do. So, and maybe not to the magnitude that I'm doing it now, like for artists and stuff like that. But, like, that's all I knew. I knew my dad was the guy, you know. And then, you know, branching to my mom, singing in the choir, branching to my uncles, having a gospel group, you know, and kind of being local stars or whatever.
Yeah.
And my cousin is the lead singer of Pieces of a Dream.
Really?
So, yeah. Wow. So my cousin Norwood Young. And so he, you know, he opened up a lot of, you know, eyes for me to see the different arranging and stuff like that and what it took to make an album. And all of this I'm taking in and not really knowing what I was going to do with that information. Wow. So what I say for Philadelphia, you know, embracing me and adopting me is because it put me in a different environment to see that musicians could make a living on a more professional level. And one of the first guys I met going to Philly was Amir Questlove Thompson, and he just kind of like took me under my wing. Any interview I do, the world knows that's my MD. He will forever be my MD. He's MD so many things currently and before me. He pretty much, you know, put me in a position to take what he's done and run with it.
What was your first pro gig? Was it from him or when I say
yeah pro? So in Philadelphia at the time, 2000, man, I was blessed to that was the neo soul boom, 2000, yeah. 2001 2002. So I was the workhorse local musician, you know, doing gigs for $30, $35, $50, but I was always like diligent in what I did. I was on time. I tried to show up.
Say that again. You were what?
I was just diligent and trying to be a good. And I was on time. You know, I tried to know my music and show up. And one of the first things I remember doing was just chilling at the studio every day after class, like having my bass and just chilling, like with no real concept in mind of what I was about to do. And Amir and James Poyser just saw me at the studio. And, you know, I remember one day Pino ain't show up because I think he got caught with, like, the Who or something.
Wow.
And it was like, get your big tail in here. Let's play some bass lines. It's all good. So, that's how Philly was. And at that point, like I said, the neo soul boom, Jill Could Walk Through There, Erykah Badu, Bilal, Music Soul Child, Eric Benet. Kenny Lattimore, I remember, you know, Jazzy Jeff had Touch of Jazz Studios, Shantae Moore. They were doing so much music, and it was just a revolving door.
Yeah.
And that was really my start in knowing what team meant to the value of what I do.
Talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, that's who I am. I'm only as an MD for me. I'm only as good as my team is, and I'm able to designate many different things, because as an MD, I would have to say it's about 25 to 30% music, and the rest is the people business, as Ray said, and then politics, and then also, you know, depending on the style of music you're playing, you know, when I go and do Justin Timberlake, it's like they want to see what the lights is doing in the video, you know what I mean? So it's like my music has to match that, you know what I'm saying? Or if I'm doing the Super Bowl, like we said, it's like you're like, okay, cool, yeah, that chord is cool, but like, you know, where is the hydraulic lifting you up at that point, you know what I mean? So
movie scripts to all the six to J Lo to this clips. I stay grounded as the amounts roll in. I'm real, I thought I told you. I'm really no Oprah. That's just me. Nothing phony, don't hate on me. What you get is what you see. Don't be fooled by the rocks that I got. I'm still Jenny from the block. Used to have a little, now I have a lot. No matter where I go, we from the Bronx, New York. You want me, yeah, me, love is crazy.
So, you know, depending on what we're doing, you know, it's more about that in a pop vein, you know what I mean, in specific show. So the team that I have that does concentrate or can concentrate primarily on music or primarily on programming with my programmers or primarily on arranging and transcribing charts, that's a big deal for me. That I'm only as good as my team, because if a chart is wrong, you know, that's still my fault. You know what I mean? So it's like I have to designate, but I also have to trust. And then, you know, as I look over them and we develop these working relationships, you know, because I kind of work with the same people a lot, but that's just because we trust each other. You know what I mean? And I think everybody here has their go-tos. It's, you know, yeah, they're our friends, and they happen to be good musicians, but it's more about the trust. You know what I'm saying?
Right. How many times have you found yourself in that situation? And that's what, again, that's where the Power MD title comes up for me, because it's not just a group of musicians that you put together to get some songs done. You know, that's in
not at all.
That's in, you know.
And I'm gonna speak for everybody here. I don't know how we grew up, but I can guarantee we've all been burned at some point earlier by hiring the homie.
The homie band.
You know, it's not just a group. It's not just a group of people that you put together just to like kind of shed, or you know, just. Right. You know, this is a profession. This is people are calling us specifically, these gentlemen, for their sound, for their business acumen, and you know, we have to withhold that because it starts with us. You know,
exactly. And I'm sure there's plenty of times where you might not even be at the rehearsal yet, but it got to be running.
Got to be gone. Yep. Or I'm at dance rehearsal. You know, trying to. You know, this just happened to me for Super Bowl. It's like, I couldn't even get to my band rehearsal because they wanted me to see where they was, you know, popping and dancing so I could put the hits in, you know what I mean?
Hence, which comes in having a band of MDs, meaning just responsible, reliable people
you don't have
to worry about. They're not going to be sitting there chilling in lounge or in the green room acting like they stars and waiting for you.
Nah. And if they are, if I walk in and they are, that's because they done put the work in. So I'm like, let me hear what's going on.
Right. Exactly. Let me ask you this. Do you have any other interests than music? Any other hobbies?
Yeah, man. I'm a father. You know what I mean? My son's career, he's 4 years old, so I'm going to say career.
Okay.
But, like, he's an actor, and he's done some Nickelodeon and television and stuff, and I see myself, like, being a dadager, real fast. You know what I mean? You know, and so yeah, I think family is, you know, a big interest of mine, and just even the people around me. You know, as I get older, of course, my parents are getting older, so right. That's one of the things that matters to me, because you know, outside of music, man, that's all we got. I hear about the good old days, like kind of like late 90s when I was a teenager, like Clapton and, mm-hmm. you know, I see Dave Matthews, they all got their own bus.
And, you know. Man got a bus, the
yeah, you bus, know.
Dave got his own bus.
Yeah, you know, I hear about old Sting gigs and kind of stuff like that, you know, but I must say that, and this is not to be deep at all, but like, you know, I really feel like what God has for me is for me. And if it's somebody else on the gig, it's all good. I can honestly say I've never tried to undercut anybody. Perfect example is, you know, I was with Kanye 05, 06, 07, 08. Mm-hmm. One random day, like it was New Year's Eve, he was like, yo, I'm just going to DJ for the rest of the year. You know what I'm saying? So it was like, you know, I couldn't be mad, because that's his right. You know what I'm saying? They end up doing like Watch the Throne after that. Him and Jay-Z was just like Omar and the DJ. You know what I mean? So, you know, it happened. I remember being on tour and the young lady got pregnant and she was like, yo, tour's over. You know what I mean? So they're human as well. Sometimes we look at them as these invincible people because of what they do. Right. But, you know, each artist, each television production, you know, each show, they have the right to wake up and go in another direction.
Right.
I think that for me, as long as I know when I was there or once I got there or when I was leaving, that I did the best that I could do, you know, that's all I concentrate on, is doing what I can do. Because even with all these guys, man, I think we all are different. We're the same when it comes to like being our greatest individually, but we all do something different that, you know, is appealing to different people.
Right. Tell me a little bit about Basic Black. When did that start?
Yeah, so Basic Black is my company, BBE for short. Me and my wife started that in 2010, and it was at a time where I was juggling a lot of gigs, and artists began to trust me to put people in place when I physically couldn't be there. So we turned into a production and music staffing company, and for the last 9 to 10 years, it's been going great. The artists know that with my stamp of approval, their shows and tours or tracks are going to be right because my name is on it, and I pride myself in that as well. I can't be everywhere at one time. You know, there's a couple of relationship people that I try to drop everything for and be there for. But also, you know, when I can't be there, the artist still wants to feel like you giving them 100% of everything. I don't even want to just say time. They want four hundredths, you know what I'm saying? And if we doing four gigs or five gigs, you know, that's 400ths times four. So it's like, you know, I've been able to build through my company, similar to like a dance agency, but almost like, you know, my company will staff it. I'll come out, you know, specifically if it's a newer artist or something like that, you know, oversee and make sure it's cool, you know, even do some arrangements. But if I can't go out on the road with you or can't be a part of this specific show, just know that my company name is on it. That's just like you're getting me.
Like, I know you still did your job, but you had a starstruck moment.
For sure. Jay-Z, number one.
Okay.
'03 for me, Jay-Z, that was kind of the first big gig that Questlove put me on. He was the musical director. Mm-hmm. I was just a bass player, and I was like, I know all your songs, bro. Like, I know them already.
Right.
And you know, I still get it to this day, man. Usher is another one that I haven't worked as directly with. We've done some television shows and stuff like that, but he's another one. Brandy, I would say, is mm-hmm. another one. I you know, the Winans.
Yes, sir.
I never worked with them, but like I watch Kern and yes, Stephen Ford videos where they got these big blue double breasted suits on. and they're ones for me. Whitney, when I watch, you know, Ricky play with Whitney, yeah. and especially, you know, I began to appreciate her voice later on for me, like around Waiting to Exhale. I'm just being honest. Like, I was like, wait a minute, like, that might be the best thing I've ever, one of the best voices I've ever heard. You know, in a situation like this, just for instance, you know, I'm doing a lot of pre-records, and it's like, that's super dope that, you know, you could potentially be that one person, you know what I'm saying, that you can just do it all. So, you know, one of the things I encourage the youth to do is just to learn multiple crafts, you know what I'm saying, like whether that be mixing or editing or programming, or, you know, mm-hmm. I'm huge on sight reading too, because I always wanted to be the session guy.
Wow.
And, you know, I'm getting a lot of calls while I'm home to kind of do underscore and movie stuff. And they just send you they send you this chart, and it's just like, go, you know what I mean? I can't be like, well, can you send a bass stem, or is there a reference or anything like that? So, you know, knowing multiple facets even of the music has helped me flourish as well. You know what I mean? Because, you know, this is the perfect time to say, like, you know, things are going to shift. Things are shifting.
Right.
You know, touring might be over as we know it.
Speaking of shifting, like, where do you think it's going? Like, a lot of people are saying, man, it's never going to be the same again.
I agree. I hate to say I, but I agree. I don't think it's ever going to be the same. Or if it gets back to the same, it's going to be a while. Mm-hmm. Of course, for safety reasons, it might be hard to put crowds in a venue. Mm-hmm. But I was talking to my dude over at Live Nation. He was just saying, like, he can't even route a tour because we don't know what the NBA and NHL is going to do, because they get first dibs on the venues. You know what I mean? So,
wow.
You know, touring is going to be changed, I would say, forever. I still haven't figured out. I'm gonna ask you guys. I have a question,
okay.
But like, you know, how to track live at the same time through a Zoom or something like that with no latency. So maybe we could talk about that later. But So I think it's really just gonna be about supply and demand. Like, you know, if somebody needs something, are you going to be able to give them what they need, no matter what that is, whether it's a track, whether it's a score, whether it's a chart, whether it's an arrangement to send, you know, via email or whatever, like, you know, how much can you do outside of the touring business?
Any words of wisdom or encouragement?
Yeah, I would just encourage all the youth and the younger musicians, and, you know, not even necessarily young in age, but, you know, in experience possibly. But if you believe in yourself, you know, continue to do what you do. You know what I'm saying? What I've learned is that every gig, no matter if it's at the club, the church, you know, the bar, whatever, restaurant, it's an audition for the next gig.
Yeah.
So you have to go and prepare, you know, there's no arenas now. So if you're doing some local gigs, you know, you never know. Rachel might walk up in there and be like, cool. Or Daniel might walk into a situation, or Onree or Kenny, you know what I mean? So I'm a testament to that. You know what I'm saying? As I was making my rounds in Philadelphia, at the local soul spots, you know, Questlove walked in, and it was, that's all it took for me. So if I would have been treating it like, oh, this is only paying me $55, I ain't going, Mm-hmm. You know, I ain't gonna do this right or prepare right. Mm-hmm. No. And then, you know, like I said, the presentation, I guess, I feel like some of the younger cats, because of Instagram or because of YouTube even, they can just play so good. But sometimes it's about presentation and the character coming through the screen and stuff like that. So mm-hmm. think about things past the music as well. You know what I'm saying? It's all an audition. It's all an audition. If I find you and you killing it, and then I go to your Twitter, your Instagram, and you know you rolling a blunt or something, it's like I can't put you in front of, you know, my guy Eminem, who's like a recovering addict. You know what I'm saying? I'm just being honest. That's the truth. You know what I'm saying? Like I can't put you on the Mary Mary gig. You know what I'm saying? And you out here, you know, disrespecting women or something online. You know what I mean? So it's like, you know, everything is outside of music matters. And I think if people could really understand that, I think they have the aspiration to be where we are is going to happen sooner than later, for sure. It's always somebody's time. Like, and it's enough gigs, to be honest, to go around. And you know, these gentlemen, including myself, we support everybody and what they do. So that's the cool thing about it. So, you know, just be prepared. You know that each gig is a stepping stone to the next thing. And just know it's not just about the music. It's about the character as well.
Mr. Ray Chu. The heart of the show really is Ray Chu and the crew.
Thank you, Ray.
The baddest band in the land and our musical director. Please give a big hand for Ray Chu and his orchestra.
Ray Chu.
Yeah. All of y'all know who Ray Chu is. I'll just give you a quick background. You can check him out at raychu.com. He's a musical director for he's been a musical director for everybody. Just to drop a few names: Rihanna, Carrie Underwood, Pharrell, Aretha Franklin, James Taylor, Quincy Jones, hundreds more. Ray's been in this. If anybody watched Showtime at the Apollo, Ray was doing this back then when some of the artists today weren't artists. Okay, so he was playing for artists from generations. Okay, you're mentioning people like Aretha Franklin and Quincy Jones. And his lovely wife, Vivian Scott Chu. The two of them, they do multiple projects even together. They do a thing at Carnegie Hall, Night of Inspiration, where he conducts a 64-piece orchestra, and he's joined by a 200-voice mass choir. Ray's done Grammy Awards, BET Awards, Showtime at the Apollo, Presidential Inauguration, American Idol. He's currently doing Dancing with the Stars. Ray, you are definitely the talent.
Sheesh.
Yeah.
That's it?
Yeah. That's not that's it, but that's all I'm going to say.
Yeah.
The show is kind of for everybody, so we could keep it on just Ray, and I'll keep talking.
We'll be here a long time. Well,
first of all, everybody go way back with you. You know, Onree, Kenny, Daniel, Adam, you guys, hats off to you, man. And I love what you're doing. I'm your biggest cheerleader. When I see you guys doing stuff, and I catch you on TV, catch you, whatever you're doing, I'm cheering you on. I want you to know. Vice versa.
Absolutely.
I thought you was about to cry there, Ray.
No. No crying.
I thought you was about to cry.
Yeah. Look, I'm shedding a tear. Yeah.
Yeah. It's all love here too.
But you know what? I want to talk a little bit about MD'ing, and it's not to the panel. This is to the people who are watching.
Right.
And hopefully, you know, there are a lot of young musicians who are aspiring and to do what we do. And as a matter of fact, I want you to know, I'm looking for you. I want to build on what we've done, because I stand on the shoulders of people like Hal Wheeler and H.B. Barnum and Quincy and people like that who have shown me how to do what I do, who showed me the craft. And so, you know, being a music director for different entities, it means you have to be able to switch and turn your hat around. It used to be that you just lead a band and you prepare the music for the artist. Well, yeah, you could still do that. But even if you're on tour, you're doing more than just leading the band. You got to be an audio engineer. You got to learn how to do all of the technology. And you also have to be in the artist relations business. And everybody in here knows what I'm talking about. You got to learn how to be Switzerland in the midst of world war. You know, you got to take care of your band. You got to lead your band. Mm-hmm. And you've got to be able to deal with your artist. And that's a handful right there.
Right.
That's a handful right there. A handful right there. I know I could probably look at Daniel Moore right now and he could say it's a labor of love, and yes. and all of us know that about, you know, the wonderful artists that we have been, that they entrust us with their music. And so that's a big lift right there. When you got a legendary world-class artist and they entrust you with their music, That's a heavy responsibility. So now we take that and we work with that and we take that bond and we have to go back and lead a band. Now when you have to lead a band, the first thing is that, you know, is as much work that, as it takes just doing the A part with the artist relations, you have to now go back and be the most knowledgeable person about the music. You can't lead what you don't know. Can't be what you don't know. So when you put the music up there, you better know it better than anybody in the room. And if you don't, your musicians will probably let you know. So, yeah, in one way or the other, right? I'll be a star. 'Cause baby, you got me open. I won't deny you got me open. Open time before your doors are closing. And I'll walk right in. That, so it's a lot of things. And then you take that craft that we built up over the years, learning how to do that and all the calluses we develop. And then you go to different arenas. You go, you know, Kenny Seymour's on Broadway. I deal with network TV and the many years of, well, about the first show I did was Saturday Night Live. I did that. And boy, when I say the dates, you're going to really date me. I was there during the Eddie Murphy years. So that was my first television job. Wow. And, you know, live TV, you have to fly without a net. And you have to make, so musically, everything has to be prepared, but you have to also be prepared for the X Factor. You don't know what's going to happen. So many years on Saturday Night Live when I did that, many things happen, and you got to find a way to fix it right there. You know, there is no fix it later. And so that prepared me for Showtime at the Apollo. And I did, I think I did like 15 seasons, which is a long time in TV. Wow. It's a long time. Wow. Steve Harvey. And we did that in front of, well, as you know, a potentially hostile audience. You know, if the audience thought we wasn't playing the right stuff, they'd,
that's Harlem.
You know, it'd turn on you in a minute. So,
all day.
Yeah, yeah, and that's home for me. And that's right. And Reggie, that's your home. You know how that is.
Yes. Yeah.
And so, you know, then, you know, stepping from there to network TV and all the years at BET doing all their specials and all that wonderful stuff, and then American Idol, and going into network series. Now, when I kind of got over into network stuff, there again, being an MD wasn't enough. That's not enough.
Right.
Knowing to be a great bass player or a great piano player, that ain't enough. Knowing just how to deal with artists, that ain't enough. Now I got to deal with, you know, executive producers, wannabe executive producers. Whoops, did I say that?
Okay.
All kinds of people that are in the fray and make something that is already challenging. They bring it. You can multiply that by 10 and 100. And then the shows that I do, you know, like Dance with the Stars, which is live TV, right, where we have to put all the components together. And again, switch the on switch in front of millions of people, and you're it.
Please welcome our fantastic pro.
There's a boy I know, he's the one I dream of. Looks into my eyes, takes me to the clouds above.
Anyway, I said a lot, Phil. I said a lot, and I don't want to hog the time, but I want to speak directly to the aspiring musician. So learn your craft, of course. Be the best that you can be on your instrument. Learn all there is to learn about everything. I studied many instruments, including violin, cello, a percussion. I was also, besides piano, I also was all city percussion. My business on the violin was pretty short, I have to tell you that. But I learned a lot. I had a teacher who you know how teachers are supposed to encourage you, you know?
Uh-oh.
She actually asked me to stop.
Oh, wow.
She said, this is not for you.
So wait, how did that not in you, like hurt and just hurt you, man, crush you in your career?
That wasn't my primary instrument was piano, and then also percussion. But anyway, like you said, you know, the people that can encourage and inspire you, that means a lot. I had a lot of great mentors and people that helped me, and nobody gets anywhere without some significant help.
Absolutely.
So I thank all those people.
Absolutely.
I had the floor.
That's true.
And Janelle, she's wonderful. She's probably one of the best assistants, production assistants I've ever seen. But has there ever been a time where you were so swamped with multiple projects going on at one time, you didn't know how, like within a week or within a day?
I've had, you know, the great fortune of having a wealth of blessings. And sometimes, and everybody on this panel knows, sometimes they all the calls happen at one time. Everybody wants you at the same time. And you know, we're in the eat as you go business. So it's hard.
Right,
you don't want to turn things down if you, especially things that are big and wonderful. You know,
right.
Somebody calls you while you're doing the Grammys to do the Super Bowl. I know, Adam, you're going to do both. You're going to find a way to do both, right?
Find a way. That's what happens.
You got to figure it out. And the rehearsals are probably at the same time.
Say yes and figure it out later.
Right.
That's right. And then the rehearsals, they want them at the same time. Everybody wants to rehearse.
Exactly. They want it at the same time, and no excuses. And if you take it, you take it, right? You can't fall short in any one of those areas. And people don't understand what a big responsibility is to do that. And I commend you guys on that.
Now I'm going to jump in here, and I'm going to say that it was your wonderful preparation that met the opportunity, and you made it a success. And thank so, you. And I would have never, never left that in the hands of somebody that I didn't trust.
Right.
So I knew that you, you know, were not only wonderfully skilled, but I knew that you had the temperament and everything else to handle that moment. It's a highly stressful thing to be thrown in, especially in the show that's in motion. Everything just has to be right. And right. So I'll say hats off to you, Reggie, when your moment came and I said I knew I couldn't make shows 8 and 9, I said Reggie Young can do it, and he's ready to do it, and I could go about my business knowing that he's going to take care of that. You respect your team because your team is going to help deliver the product. Your team is the vehicle for which your product speaks.
Ray, talk a little bit about like what's happening with you now. I know we skipped a whole lot. Like I wanted to talk a little bit about Ashford and Simpson, I believe was one of your early starts as well. But I mean, again, RayChew.com, RayChew Live on Facebook. Everybody watching, if you want to know a lot more, and you should, about Ray, go check that out. I want to give him the opportunity to talk a little bit about what he's doing right now during this pandemic.
Well, you know, during this time, I've known firsthand how the plight of musicians and how it's affected musicians. Musicians, for the most part, you know, gig musicians, they go from gig to gig,
right.
You know, and we're talking about really great studied and, you know, great musicians. They go from, they'll do a great tour, and then when they come back, they got to figure out what they're going to do after the tour. They have to play a couple of clubs. They have to knit together a system to make a living. It's not right. Like you got, that you know you got a steady check every week. That's not the way that part of the business works. Sometimes when you get into other areas, you know, in Broadway, that gets better. But for most of the part, gig musicians are really struggling. And right now, when the tour is over, there's no tours, there's no clubs, there's no club dates, there's no any kind of live music. So for those musicians, there is nothing. So I felt that in my heart and in my system. I know I've been blessed, and I've been very blessed. So, you know, when each one is blessed, there's a blessing, there's a responsibility to give back. So my inspiration was, I said, let me go and do something. Let me do something. So what I came up with was a Facebook Live series. So it's a four-part series, and we did the first one yesterday. Four-part series where the proceeds go directly to gig musicians. Now, I'll tell you about, and before I tell you about the series, I'm going to tell you about that, because anytime you deal with money, people want to know where their money's going,
right.
And the people who need it want to know how they get it.
Right.
So we set up a portal. And this was in cooperation with the International American Federation of Musicians, the AFM. And so it's all of the locals under the leadership of Raymond Hare, who's the international president. And also with the AFL-CIO and with BMI. So the portal is set up that when you text to give, the money will go directly to mm-hmm. these gig musicians. And the gig musicians, if you're listening and you need help, you need money, you can apply through the AFM to get some funds. Now, this application process so that they don't just have anybody trying to get money that is earmarked for you.
During this pandemic, I have been trying to assist people in different causes and this, that, and the other. But I never actually did the text this number and put in the word music. And I said, all right, let me follow this through because this is my boy, so I'm not worried about it. If anything, I'll just call Ray up and be like, give my money back.
well, let me interject right here. The money, Ray Chu doesn't touch any of the money. The money goes directly.
I know. Okay. I know. Hey, everybody, listen, we're all friends. So we just, every now and then we're being silly. But anyway, I did it. And sure enough, a link pops right up on the text. It takes you right to the direction you need to go. And you're in complete control of what you want to do, how much you want to give, $5, $10, $25, other, whatever it may be. And I just felt good to do it. Like I said, I'm a musician too. We all are, but we can help each other, right? I just wanted Artie to come on here just to surprise you and say, what's up, man? I know you guys basically live together on the road. And now that's not really happening, right? So I figured it'd bring a smile to your face to see your brother.
Yeah, hey. That was cool.
Hey, I just got to come in and give props, Ray. I just want to say thank you for all you've done for me. You're a hell of an MD. I learned a lot of shit watching you. Sorry for cursing. And I just want to give you your props. I want to say what's up to the fellas.
Yeah, man.
Good job. Hey, listen, and everything, first of all, just caring enough to take a minute to think about those who've fallen through the cracks.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's a lot of people, you know, toting what they got and the government help, but there's a lot of people still hurting. You know what I mean? So big ups for that.
Yeah.
The other thing is, in some of the things he said about being an MD, I have a whole complete, contact sampler file of all the different versions of people saying, Ray, 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 Ray. Post that down below afterwards.
Please do.
It's amazing just watching the maestro work. So I just wanted to chime in and give him a shout out and shout out all you guys, Onree, Kenny, Adam, all you guys, man. It's just amazing.
Thank you, bro. Be safe out there, man.
Yeah. All right, fellas.
All right, continue watching, man, all right?
Absolutely, this is awesome.
Okay, man, thank you.
All right, see y'all soon.
All right. Peace. Hey, Ray, I really appreciate it, man. Everybody go to raychu.com, check out his stuff, Ray Chu Live. He has another topic that I think he calls Chew On This, where he talks about some things. And
I'm just happy to, you know, have you guys all on the panel. Thank you, Reggie, for putting this thing together. That's pretty great, man. Yeah. No, I'm going to stay. I want to hear what everybody got to say. I'm waiting to hear. I want to hear what everybody got to say. Yeah, I ain't going nowhere. Go.
It's the deacon's meeting. It's the deacon's meeting. The deacon board. The bishop's board. What's it like working with Ray Chu?
Wow. So it's like working with Ray Chu. Ray Chu's still on here, right?